I don't have to tell you things are bad. Everybody knows things are bad. We know the air is unfit to breathe and our food is unfit to eat. We sit watching our TVs while some local newscaster tells us that today we had 15 homicides and 63 violent crimes, as if that's the way it's supposed to be. We know things are bad, worse than bad. They're crazy. It's like everything everywhere is going crazy, so we don't go out anymore. We sit in the house, and slowly the world we're living in is getting smaller, and all we say is, please, at least leave us alone in our living rooms. Let me have my toaster and my TV and my steel-belted radios, and I won't say anything. Just leave us alone. Well, I'm not going to leave you alone. I want you to get mad. I don't want you to protest, I don't want you to riot, I don't want you to write to your congressmen because I wouldn't know what to tell you to write. I don't know what to do about the depression and the inflation and the Russians and the crying in the street. All I know is that first, you've got to get mad! You've got to say, I'm a human being! God damn it! My life has value!
Awaken. You are the universe experience in itself. You are not just meat and bone. You are not the result of random processes. You are more than just your identity. You are more than just your role in society. You are more powerful than you can possibly imagine. You are the process. You are the void before the universe. You are the Big Bang and all that came after. Awaken. Become reborn. Become who you were born to be. Around the world, humans are realizing that society, religions, governments, and economic systems are illusionary constructs, part of the matrix, designed to keep us from knowing who we are. Our true history has been erased, replaced by a false narrative. The evidence ignored, the facts ridiculed, the truth of the matter not known. People accept the world that they are brought up in without question. They take it all as a given, the structures of society, never to see past the veil. We all live in the matrix, a system designed to imprison the collective mind, a system that deceives the masses, appearing as a collection of separate nations with different political ideologies. Humans have been manipulated, twisted to become a mockery of everything we once stood for. We are capable of enhancing ecosystems, caring for all forms of life, and protecting the Earth from comets. But instead, we're fooled to support systems that will use our intelligence against us. Cognitive dissonance occurs when the mind rejects reality in order to preserve its established belief systems, religious, political, and philosophical. We've been brought up in these societies that people deem to be right and normal. However, all this is a facade. Humanity was once as advanced, if not more advanced, than we are now, long before recorded history. These ancient humans were advanced, dedicated their culture to uncovering the mysteries of the nature of reality, and in doing so gained access to higher realms via consciousness. This now lost civilization was wiped out by a catastrophic event at the end of the last ice age, whether by a comet or by artificial means. This catastrophe changed the surface of the Earth, submerging many parts of the world and scattering the surviving humans. Generations of survival would ensue during the hellish 1,000-year era of the Younger Dryas period. And the later humans, who resettled around the world, separated from one another, would restart civilization again and begin recorded history as we know it, leading up to the societies of today. And during this era of history, this last 10,000 years, the Earth has been the target of a truly despicable foe. As far-fetched as all this sounds, this is a truth that one must see for themselves. This isn't science fiction. This is the return of you. The universe seems to be a multidimensional fractal living organism, and all things in the universe are interconnected by virtue of quantum entanglement, a thread that links all subatomic particles in the universe to their origin, the singularity before the Big Bang. Meaning that through the lens of quantum mechanics, we can confirm ancient spiritual belief systems that state we are all one.
But what this tells us is that once matter is physically joined, even when it becomes separate, the energy is still there that's connecting it. And this is why it's important to me, because if we go back far enough in time, all the particles of matter of this entire universe that are expanding were all meshed together in a single particle about the size of a green pea, is what scientists tell us today, is what the computer models suggest. That if you could go into the universe today and take all the particles of matter and take out all the space in between and bring it together and compress it into a size of a single green pea, it means that you and me and every one of our listeners, we were all once part of that same particle that creates this whole universe today. And even though those particles are now separate and expanding, and studies show that they are, energetically we're all still linked.
Science is the observation of reality. And reality is something beyond our comprehension. In attempts to rationalize the world around us, we try to compartmentalize it. Our definition of life has been filtered by our frame of reference, structured by the societal paradigm that we were born into. On the one hand, our society views the earth as a rock with life on it, formed by random circumstances in a chaotic universe. On the other hand, Aboriginal people view the Earth as a living organism, part of something greater, a living universe. Diving into reality at the quantum level, there is no distinction between the atoms that make up a living organism versus atoms that make up inanimate objects. At this level of perception, all things are boundless, flowing energy. Our brain filters out 97% of reality, leaving us with a tiny bandwidth of perception limited to our five senses. Senses that of which are tuned into perceiving baryonic matter, which makes up only 3% of the universe. Meaning what we think is real is based on the brain.
What is real? How do you define real? If you're talking about what you can feel, what you can smell, you can taste and see, then real is simply electrical signals interpreted by your brain.
The universe may very well be a multidimensional living thing, a living field of ether manifesting as all things in known reality.
And these worlds of form, frequencies, vibrating frequencies, are created in this way, out of all possibility. And there are endless, infinite realms with different so-called laws of physics, different challenges, different experiences, all vibrating at different speeds and therefore able to share the same space. All of these different realms are sharing the same space that I'm sharing now, just as all the radio and television stations broadcasting to this city are sharing the space that I'm sharing now and the space that they're sharing with each other. So we live in a frequency range. And that frequency range is dictated by the range of frequencies that our body computers can decode. And it is extraordinarily tiny. We're virtually blind in terms of what exists. The vast majority of this universe is what scientists call dark energy or dark matter. And they call it dark not because it's pitch black, but because we cannot decode it. Therefore, it is not in our realm of experience. We have to work it out by its impact on things that we can see. And the electromagnetic spectrum is 0.005% of what is projected to exist in this universe. And visible light, which is the only frequency range that we can decode, is a fraction of the 0.005%. So this is it. Visible light, this is our world. And we look out and we think we can see everything. But we can't. We can see what we can decode. And therefore, we operate within a dimension, you might call it, and it's penetrated by other dimensions, which allows those other dimensions to interact with ours.
Reality is far more majestic than what society makes it out to be. From this view, all things that happen, happen because of higher dimensional causalities. We were born into the world as it appears to be, and we assume things are the way that they are supposed to be. Our lives are too short to take in the events of history within the vast spans of time, so we feel events are disconnected. When in fact, there has only been one constant story. Our perspective shapes our reality. The perspective of the collective shapes our world. We've been brought up to view the universe as a mechanistic thing. Let's take a step back and observe life from a different perspective. In reality, there are no borders, no countries, no economic systems, no philosophies, no separation between the processes of the universe. We have all created these concepts within our minds and agreed to them. To break out of this mental prison and achieve gnosis would mean we'd have to develop respect for all things in the universe, animate and inanimate.
The structure of the world itself is such, it functions on natural law, and the natural law is a powerful regenerative process. There's a process of regeneration that continues and grows and is endless. It's absolutely endless if everyone agrees to the law and follows the law. But if you challenge the law, and you think you're going to change the law, and you're bound to failure. And then that failure will be a lot of pain, because the natural law has no mercy. It is only the law.
The indigenous people practiced shamanism. By accessing higher states of consciousness, they were able to conceive the notion that the universe is material matter, minded by spiritual forces. They say the spirit world is all around us at all times. It seems they were describing the complexities of higher dimensions using metaphors. We exist in the third dimension, which the shamans refer to as the physical realm. The higher dimensions, from their view, are regarded as the spirit realm, where everything is interconnected. All things are interconnected. The universe as we experience it is a physical manifestation of higher dimensional causalities. The brain may not be the generator of consciousness, but a transceiver of consciousness, meaning that the relationship between consciousness and the brain might be similar to the relationship between a TV signal and a TV set.
And I stick by this, that there is nothing in neuroscience that rules this out. See, the materialist scientist will say, I know your brain makes your consciousness, because if I damage this or that area of your brain, this or that area of your consciousness will blink out. It will be gone. Therefore, that proves that your brain made that bit of your consciousness. But isn't that true with the TV analogy too? If you damage the TV screen, the picture won't be quite so good, will it? But the TV signal will still be there. The signal will still be perfect. And there's nothing that I'm aware of in neuroscience that rules out this possibility, that the brain is actually a transceiver of consciousness rather than a generator of consciousness. The brain is the interface between a non-material and a material realm through which consciousness manifests on this plane. And I mean, this is broadly the view of all spiritual traditions.
The brain receives the signal, consciousness, and projects it through the neurological processes that creates your personality, your identity, your ego. This is the basis of all spiritual beliefs, that the body is a vehicle for the soul. The soul and whatever consciousness is are synonymous. Consciousness may very well be another fundamental force of reality. At the quantum level, everything is basically an interconnected field of energy, an infinite flux of reality.
There is energy in nature which gives things actuality, activity, movement, change, flow. And there's energy in the whole universe which flows through many different forms. This energy can be converted to other forms of energy. The energy of light can be converted to chemicals in trees and build up the trunks of trees. The energy in a slice of toast at breakfast time can fuel you or me for much of the morning. If I eat the slice of toast, it fuels my thoughts. If you eat it, it fuels your thoughts. The energy in an electric plug can power a toaster, a hairdryer, a computer, a TV set. The energy can do all sorts of different things. It can be converted to one form or another, to mechanical work, to heat, to light, to chemical energy. And yet, these forms of the energy itself is, as it were, completely promiscuous. It doesn't have any shape or form on its own. It's a principle of activity in nature which the Hindus call Shakti. The concept of Shakti, this kind of blind, undirected energy underlying all things, is very similar to the modern physical concept. But it takes lots of different forms. And why does it take different forms? Because it's organized by fields. Fields organize energy. They give energy form or structure. They are not themselves energy, but they organize energy. Energy is not itself a field, but is organized by fields.
Quantum mechanics talks of entanglement between particles over vast distances in the space-time continuum. They will always be connected, no matter how far apart. Every single particle in and of this universe was once one, a singularity before the Big Bang. This modern realization of reality is merely a rediscovery of what the Aboriginal people of the world have been saying all along. All things are made from spirit. We are all one, constantly changing shape and form over the great epochs of time. Energy cannot be created or destroyed, it can only change its state. And these are not based on random events, but by intelligent, multidimensional processes. If we lay a 3D creature on a 2D reality, the two-dimensional beings wouldn't perceive the 3D creature in its entirety. They would only see the point of contact, the interference occurring between his presence. Raising the questions about experiences with supernatural beings throughout history, from ghosts to fairies, angels and demons, could it be that we've been communicating with higher dimensional entities? Shamans speak of these realities, as well as the entities who inhabit them, and how they are affecting our dimension.
Certain categories of beings that are referred to in traditions all around the world, shamans call them spirits. In medieval Europe, they were called fairies and elves. And in modern society, I would suggest they're called aliens. That all of these are the result of experiences in altered states of consciousness. And that if we are in the alert problem-solving mode of consciousness, we are not going to have those experiences. But in an altered state of consciousness, there's a remarkable unanimity and uniformity and similarity amongst these three supposedly different categories of beings, spirits, fairies, and so-called aliens today. I found that there are really astonishing similarities amongst these three categories of beings. Very commonly, shamans, just as we saw from the painted caves, will encounter a spirit being in a therianthropic form, part animal and part human. I was astonished to discover that fairies in medieval Europe were also very frequently encountered in that form. And again, in the modern phenomenon of alien abductions, and we have massive documentation on this as a result of John Mack's work, for example. Very frequently, the abductee will first see a being who is an animal, or part animal and part human in form, later perhaps transforms into the more familiar gray type of entity. So there's that common motif running through all three of these experiences. What were fairies best known for and feared for in medieval Europe? It was abducting human beings. What are aliens today best known and feared for? Abductions. What happens with shamans? Very frequently they experience an abduction into the spirit world. It's their first encounter. All of these are essentially the same experience, just being viewed through slightly different cultural spectacles. With human beings, interpretation is built into perception from the very beginning. So we should expect our culture to shape our perceptions, but that doesn't mean that there isn't a real basis to those perceptions. And, you know, to cut a long story short, I would say that the beings that shamans call spirits, the beings that medieval Europeans called fairies and elves, and the beings that modern Americans call aliens are all the same beings. Fairies were most commonly seen around megalithic sites in ancient Europe. Maybe those huge megalithic constructions, Stonehenge and Avebury and other such places, were built where they were built because there's some phenomenon in the earth, some energy of the earth, perhaps an electromagnetic energy, which affects human consciousness and opens that doorway into another realm.
The earliest therianthropes were painted on the cave walls in the ancient world, suggesting the first of these encounters occurred during the dawn of humanity. Some believe that aliens took part in the dawn of man, Again, these seem to be interpretations of much stranger occurrences, interdimensional occurrences. In our observation of these entities occurred during shamanistic rituals, which involved the consumption of psychedelics. One such psychedelic has been used by the natives of the Amazon for thousands of years. It is called ayahuasca. Those who undergo ayahuasca ceremonies report encountering other dimensional entities whom share the same description amongst different people. One entity has been so often encountered that she's been given a common name, Mother Ayahuasca. These are beings from higher dimensions that have direct influence on the happenings of this dimension. Consciousness, the soul, is not generated by the brain. The brain seems to be receiving consciousness from the source, the highest dimension from where all things came to be, the singularity. All subsequent dimensions manifest reality in different ways depending on the frequency and vibration. As we tune the frequency to our 3D level, all things in the universe appear to be separate subatomic particles. Energetically linked through mysterious forces that are responsible for phenomena such as quantum entanglement. When the brain tunes into the realms generated by DMT states, reality is revealed to be interconnected as quantum entanglement states. Forces that govern the universe are represented in visual form. The realm that of which DMT grants us access to seems to be synonymous with what the native people call the spirit world, which is also synonymous with the afterlife that religions around the world speak about. Within this spirit world are entities that seem to have a mission for mankind.
Particularly in Western technological society, have been brought up from childhood to shut ourselves off from those other areas of reality, the areas that are accessed in dreaming and visionary states. We've been taught to despise them, to regard them as aberrations, and to regard them as fictional, just made up by the brain. I don't think they're made up by the brain. The model I use is that the brain is a receiver or a transceiver of consciousness rather than a generator of consciousness. And that as such, as a transceiver, the receiver wavelength of consciousness may be adjusted. And I think that that's what happens with ayahuasca. And I think that we gain access to other levels of reality and the intelligences that inhabit those other levels of reality, which for some reason are interested in the human race. And some of them in a very dark and negative way, and some of them in a very positive and nurturing and helpful way. And many have had the experience of Mother Ayahuasca, of a female spirit, of an entity who lies behind the ayahuasca vine, who is concerned with the jungle, who is concerned with the environment, who is in a way, I called her an angel, but the mother goddess of our planet, and who realizes that the human race need help right now. We need help. Just as we are in the process of raping and destroying and burning down the Amazon jungle, it's interesting that a spirit has come out of the Amazon jungle through the medium of the ayahuasca vine and started to speak to people all over the world and saying, whoa, you know, hang on, guys. What you're doing is not smart. You need to think again about what you're doing. This is another one of the universal experiences of working with ayahuasca.
Should we all unplug from the matrix that we've been fooled into creating, we will all transcend to neo-humanism. Love and respect for all things in the universe, animate and inanimate, is at the heart of neo-humanism, which in turn would lead us to designing civilizations based on these core principles. rather than the materialistic oriented societies of today, which parasites on the earth. Perhaps the reason why we supposedly cannot find space, fear, and civilizations is because the highest point of a sentient being's evolution reflects neo-humanism, a state of mind that maintains an equilibrium with all life, rendering the need for space travel useless, much like the people displayed in the film Avatar. Humanity was once able to psychologically tap into the quantum network that binds all things. And we think we know exactly when this golden age took place. The Kemetic history calls the dawn of civilization Zep-Tepi, and it is dated at 36,400 BC. If we rewind the clocks an entire precessional cycle, it would bring us to 36,399 BC, a direct correlation connecting to the date of Zep-Tepi. An advanced worldwide civilization consisting of various species of hominid, Denisovan, Neanderthal to Homo sapien. The people of Atlantis, our ancestors, wielded the power of consciousness and manifested a reality that was a reflection of heaven onto earth, communicating with beings across the universe via interdimensional shamanistic journeys. However, at some point during our downfall, our actions lowered the vibration of the planet. This lowered vibration created the conditions for entities with ill intent who come from a different dimension to inhabit and manipulate our reality. In the previous documentary, Rebirth, we spoke of the Gnostics. All Gnostic work is derived from Hermeticism, a philosophy created by Tahuti of ancient Egypt. The Gnostics' take on Christianity was different from the versions we are aware of today. They would say that this reality, this physical dimension, is an illusion, a prison for the mind and ultimately the soul.
So both Hermeticism and Gnosticism see reality in very starkly dualistic terms. There is the spiritual realm, that's God, and then there's the world, the physical realm, which is immured in evil. And the two never can meet in these dualistic systems. And this is why the Gnostics really got themselves into trouble. They say that the entity that we have been taught to worship as God, who, whether we call him Jehovah, Yahweh, God, Allah, whatever we call him, they say, no, that is not a God. That is some kind of minor, pumped up, supernatural, who wants to be adored and loved and worshipped, who's incredibly jealous, who's constantly telling people to slaughter one another. That is not God, that's a kind of demon. They called him the Demiurge.
And it's all about the control and programming of perception. That's the only way the few, and it is a few, compared with the global population, that the billions can be controlled. Manipulating how we interact with reality, keeping from us that we are consciousness, putting us in these bubbles of our sense of limitation and I can't, manipulating the way we decode reality and therefore making us see the world as the control system wants us to see it. So yes, of course, on one level it does manifest as dark suit sitting around a table discussing the next move, but that's still the play out world. It goes into deeper levels beyond them, deep in the hidden secret society network, and eventually it goes out of this dimension. And that's where this whole thing is really coming from, beyond the frequency range of visible light.
And then those archonic forces, well, what about the state? I would say the state is another huge force in the world today that is working against the liberation of the human spirit. And again, this is something that we have to change.
if we're going to move forward, because states operate on fear and hatred and suspicion. They try to make us fearful. They try to make us hate others and suspect others. And this goes on all the time with the security business and the so-called war on terror and all of this mess that's going on in the world today. This unnecessary division between one person and another.
And our governments and the huge, gigantic corporations that really run the world are so invested in spreading fear and hatred and suspicion. Fear, hatred, suspicion, again and again and again, these messages are just churned out at us, dividing us, separating us, setting us against one another.
We are in the middle of a spiritual war, one that will decide the fate of the earth. You are a slave. Like everyone else, you are born into bondage, born into a prison you cannot smell or taste or touch, a prison for your mind.
Well, there is a network of families that you can take back to the ancient world, to places like Babylon, Sumer, which is now Iraq. You can chart them through to Rome, where they were responsible for the Roman Empire and the creation of the Roman Church. God save us from religion, by the way. And then they came up into Europe to become the European aristocracy and royal families. Then through the great empires of Europe, especially the British Empire, but others too, these family bloodlines and the secret society network through which they manipulate themselves into power were exported all over the world. And then when the point came where the European colonial powers appeared to give independence to these countries, that was only on the surface. What actually happened was the family bloodlines and the secret society network through which they manipulate was left out in these former colonies, and they've gone on controlling them ever since. So what you have is a hidden hand where events are manipulated, like 9/11, and you have a hidden hand manipulating events, and the whole goal of it is centralization of power, to the point where humans are little more than controlled clones.
Who's the hidden hand? I mean, who are these hidden hands?
This network of families I'm talking about. You find that people that are in positions of apparent power, like prime ministers and presidents, are actually puppets of the real power, which doesn't put itself on public display. Why would it?
Everyone who is still plugged into the Matrix is potentially an agent. Meaning, these dark archons work through people to derail souls who are on their spiritual journey. Most people are not ready to be unplugged. The Matrix was designed to stimulate your senses, keeping you grounded in this physical dimension. The luxury, the pleasure, the food, the power, it's all an illusion. And people are so dependent on the illusion that they will fight to defend it. When people are brought up in the Matrix, they strive to achieve an established blueprint of success. And by doing so, their soul is completely derailed from the original intention of incarnating on the planet. Our ego, the identity of self, has been mistaken as the self. The Archons have succeeded in making us comfortable within our prison. Is humanity destined to become food for energetic vampires? Or are we to break out from the illusion?
And we're at a point, a fork in the road, where we can waken and start living this world from that point of infinite consciousness and transform it, because we are the world and the world is us, they're just mirrors of each other. Or we can go on the way we're going, close down computer-based reality, in which case we'll live in a global fascist state within not many years from now. Only when we know who we are can we know freedom. Because how can we know freedom if we do not have the coordinates to understand how free we really can be? Not free of the next tax demand, not free of the next Blair Bush introduced law, not free of, but free in infinite reality, infinite awareness forever, because that's all that exists, now and forever, everything. That's the freedom that we can be and we are outside of this illusion. And that's the freedom we can only know by understanding that's who we are.
The Mayan calendar spoke of the end of one cycle and the beginning of another. The end of the great cycle occurred on December 21st, 2012. The paradigm shift has been underway, as evident by the increase in number of people unplugging from the matrix. And this ruling elite know this.
People fear to break out of the apparent normality, much like Plato's allegory in the cave. Maybe the demiurge is just an analogy for the evil that corrupts humanity. It doesn't take away from the power of the message, which is to defeat the demiurge. We must enlighten ourselves and open our hearts to love. Only then will we be able to upend the matrix and change the world.
And you know, the antidote to fear and hatred and suspicion is love. If we can simply operate with love towards one another, beginning at the very direct person-to-person level and spreading that out to the level of nations, we don't need to step over the edge of that abyss into cataclysm and into chaos.
But we're not of this world in terms of the point of observation. We are in this world, but we're observing it from here. We can see things here that this can't see. And that's why the control system has to keep us here. And structured society to make that happen. To keep us in bewilderment by being only able to decode and experience reality through the five senses. And once you are in the five senses, and you're not getting inspiration, insight, intuitive knowing from higher levels of your consciousness, where do you look to get a fix on who you are, where you are, and the world you're living in? There. And who controls that? The control system that controls the media, politics, education, science. The idea is isolate us in the five senses, isolate us in body-mind, and then program the body-mind to see the world that suits the control system.
The Archons maintain control over the human race by keeping us in a state of fear, hatred, suspicion, and division, an illusionary state. For too long, we've allowed ourselves to be food for energetic vampires who lead us to self-destruction. The time is now to remember who we are, and thus realize our role in this dimension, in this grand cosmic evolution and involutionary process. This dimension is as much a university for the soul as it is a prison for the mind and body. The prison has served its role, It is no longer needed. The powers that be are aware of how powerful we are. They are aware of the paradigm shift. They will continue to manipulate our perception of reality in order to remain in power, desperately orchestrating all the terror we see in the world in order to ensure that we remain reliant on them for the illusion of security and the tranquility of normality. Starseeds, all of you, wake up from this brainwash. Escape the Matrix and return to your rightful place. The inner being of your sovereign nature. You chose to incarnate on this planet in order to shine your light and eliminate the darkness. So illuminate, empower, and return to the gnosis and the truth that freedom is being effortlessly aligned with the infinite source of all that is. Awaken to the knowing that within you is that source, and that you truly are whole and complete just as you are. Awaken to the truth that you are enough. Awaken to the knowing that you are responsible for creating your own reality and in being aligned with the infinite source of all that is, you are empowered to create prosperity and abundance from that place. This is the gnosis and the lived reality that is the return of you, the true and sovereign you. Awaken to this truth and know thyself. And so it is.
What I feel, my view anyway, we need to do is not seek enlightenment, but remove the barriers that are keeping enlightenment out. And that is the eggshell. An eggshell made up of fear, guilt, resentment, lack of self-esteem, I can't, limited imagination of ourselves, fear. And when that starts to crack, and it's cracking for more and more people, multidimensional self starts to get access to reconnect with first gear self. And at that point, we start to perceive ourselves and life very different. Symbolically, I feel that what's happening is there are vibratory changes going on around the planet as a natural course of human evolution, which are cracking this eggshell, this low vibrational energy that is our prison. And so the light, if you want to call it that, the multidimensional self, the infinite self, is starting to get in and reconnect with this self. Suddenly, I'm seeing myself and the world very differently. Why haven't I seen it before? It's so obvious. Because now the eggshell's cracking. And it's not first gear that's making the perception process in this world. It's multidimensional self.
There's the sense of a magical universe, that we are actually not caught up in something mundane and physical and down to earth only, but in something that's deeply enchanted and magical in this adventure of life and in the incredible opportunity to be born in a human body and to undergo the teaching and learning experiences that life in a human body involves, and to live on this beautiful garden of a planet surrounded by, you know, the majestic wonder of the universe, to look up at night and see that and be part of that and wonder where we are in the scheme of things, that there is behind all this not just dead physical processes, but a profound magical intelligence which is at work in the universe.
We are the power in everyone. We are the dance of the moon and the sun. We are the hope that will never hide. We are the turning of the tide.